Why don't you just ask? Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you were mentioning about, you know, some professor from Missouri was talking about whether the electron.
Oh, yeah. Edwin Jones, yes.
So I want to link it back up to the very first question when you talk about, you know, these cyclotron like experiments set up for the for the Hall effects. So it's kind of almost like a hydrogen atom where, you know, in a sense that there is a acceleration of the electron in the classical, whether it's radiating or not. And so in this particular case, to see whether the electron is radiating, you know, going from classical to quantum, do you have to resort to QED or something more elementary or give us the answer?
Thank you. Well, it should be, I mean, it should be possible to do a calculation of the radiative transition probabilities by using non-relativistic quantum electrodynamics, I guess. Obviously, if you do the relativistic calculation and take the appropriate limit, you should get the same result. I would expect so.
So in this sense, you know, would the electrons be radiating energy?
Well, I mean, it's the usual situation, basically. As you say, it is rather likely a hydrogen atom. You have this electron which classically can actually execute a cyclotron orbit. How do you describe that quantum mechanically? Well, you have a set of energy eigenstates separated by h bar omega c. And for the moment, let's forget about the degeneracy with respect to the centre of mass position. Suppose you have you've got some kind of potential which is sort of is localising the centre of mass. Then in an energy eigenstate, of course, there's no time dependence. However, you would, just as in the hydrogen atom, expect that if you start off in an excited state, you can get a transition to the ground state emitting the cyclotron energy, H bar omega c. So, as you said, it is very similar to the
hydrogen. So, in that case, there is no time dependence, or there is no really.
Well, as I say, as always in quantum, there's always this point about the mapping between classical mechanics and quantum mechanics, which I'm afraid not too many of the textbooks do well. Many of them really rather gloss over this. But whenever you're in a quantum mechanical energy eigenstate, there's no time dependence. The time dependence comes when you have a quantum superposition of these two states, and crudely speaking, that if you want to try to get the nearest visualization of a classical state, you have to take some kind of, generally speaking, a superposition of states with large quantum numbers. Suppose, for example, my harmonic oscillator is a pendulum. And I say to myself, well, look, it has to be surely at least approximately correct to think of the at least some possible states as corresponding to the classical motion. How do I represent that in quantum mechanics? Well, I make myself a quantum superposition of rather highly excited quantum states with appropriate combinations of the coefficients. And in fact, ideally, I make myself a so-called coherent state. And I watch its time evolution. And sure enough, the center of mass of the wave packet does behave exactly as in classical mechanics.
So in this particular case, using your analogy, you know, by the time you put the superposition states, there is time evolution, and by the correspondence principle, when the h-bar kind of, you know, approaching a large number, it's kind of like classical.
It's more that, you can take the classical limit in either way by saying h-bar goes to zero or n goes to infinity. I think it's probably in this kind of context, it's more convenient to take the limit that the excitation number n becomes very large. Then you can make yourself a wave packet, which behaves according to the classical predictions.
Yeah. So therefore, in quantum, the Hall effect, you know, since, you know,
well,
the limit is not taken, then
that's right.
Radiation is
Exactly, that's right. Yes, it's important that in the in a typical quantum Hall effect experiment, it's unusual to be in for the electrons to be in an excited state, except for the rather trivial following rather trivial point, we are dealing with fermions, so we can't have more than one electron per state. Now remember that in a given Landau level, which roughly speaking corresponds to the various possible states of the harmonic oscillator, in a given Landau level there are a very large number of states available, 10 to the 23 or whatever. Okay. However, once you fill those states, that's it. You can't put any more in that state. Any other electrons have to go into the first excited state of the harmonic oscillator, the so-called second Landau level. So to that extent, you have to worry about the excited states. But since because of the Pauli principle, that's still the lowest many-body state in your system. Okay, are there any other questions arising from the last lecture? Yes.
Let's imagine that we're doing NMR experiments.
Yeah.
So in the fractional quantum Hall state, you told us that it will have fractional charge. So in that case, the hyperfine constant will change it, like fractional?
Very nice question. You would expect, I think, that the... that these fractional charges in principle would have an effect on the NMR. How to think about that? Well, one of the things I think when thinking about that kind of problem, one of the things that's important to bear in mind is that you can really only define the, in some sense, the position of your quasar particle or quasar hole within something like a magnetic length. Okay, within which there are actually a very large number there may be a large number of electrons. So my quasar hole or quasar particle is a strongly collective excitation of the electrons. When you're when you're thinking of the NMR of a particular nucleus, say, then you have to, in some sense, average over the many body wave function. So it's a good question. I think the reason it hasn't been, as far as I know, it hasn't been much explored, is because it's very difficult to do NMR on a spatial scale,
yes,
as small as the magnetic length. You're much more likely to be doing the averaged NMR over the whole sample. In which case, presumably, what you'd see there, very crudely speaking, you see the averaged effect of the quasar, the extra quasar particles and quasar holes, but since they're equal in number, this is going to average out, I would think. Okay, let me just go back for a moment to one thing which you did just briefly touch on at the end of the last lecture, and this is the statistics of fractional excitations and the Yeah, sure.
Can you reformulate what the question was?
I understood the question to be. So you have these excitations which have a fractional charge, say a third of the electron charge. Does that mean that when these excitations interact with a nucleus, say, the hyperfine constant is appropriately reduced? And as I say, the point is that unfortunately, you, in the case of a real electron, say in an insulator, obviously it's localized to within one atomic size. In the case of the quasar particles or quasar holes in the quantum Hall effect, in some sense they can't be localized on that small a length scale. So that was the question, I think. Okay, let's go back then to this question of the statistics in the fractional quantum Hall effect, because that is going to play a role in the main material of this lecture also. You remember we just very vaguely reviewed this argument, which goes back to Linus and Mirheim sometime in the 70s, about why when you've got excitations which are strictly confined to two dimensions, you can cannot necessarily assume that when you interchange them, the phase is going to be either zero or pi, zero for bosons, pi for fermions. So at least in principle, in strictly two dimensions, you do get this possibility of non-integral statistics, let's call it, okay, so-called anionic statistics. How to try to think about that? Well, imagine that we have two quasar particles. Let's say we take the standard case of the nu equals 1/3 quantum Hall effect, the sort of most basic one that was originally discovered. Then you remember that you get a hole. You get a single hole by at position say eta 1 by multiplying your original wave function by this factor here. This extra factor. That gives you then a reduction of charge density in the region close to this position eta 1. Okay, so now if we want to create two holes, what do we do? Well, we just add a pi ij here, and now a zj minus eta 2. Times minus. Let's say if we make it pi i less than j, that'll cope with the statistics aspect. So let's just make it this here times the Laughlin wave function of z1 zn. Now, if you stare at that expression there. Eta 1 and eta 2 are in some sense just classical position variables. So this has got to be symmetric under interchange of eta 1 and eta 2, and in fact it will be. Okay. Similarly, it's got to be anti-symmetric in exchange of with respect to exchange of any two electrons, because after all they're just plain fermions, right? But now the interesting question arises, as we basically briefly discussed at the end of last time, what happens if I, in some sense, pin these two, the positions of the two holes, with say a couple of STM tips, and then move these holes around and exchange them? I would expect that the many-body wave function picks up a certain phase on doing that, and the question is, what is that phase? Does that have to be zero or pi, whatever? And the standard answer is no. In fact, the phase picked up by the many-body wave function in this case is on interchange is e to the I is pi over 3. Okay. Now, how does that make any sense? I think it's, rather than thinking of interchange, it's usually simpler to think of encircling one particle by another. Then that encirclement is, except for a trivial overall shift, that encirclement is just equal to two interchanges. So what we basically said, that on encirclement we get e to the 2 pi I over 3. And how does that work? Well, crudely speaking, this is in some sense a combination of two factors. One is that in a situation where I've got, how to put this, suppose I've got a quantum object which is fluctuating substantially between two possible states. For example, I have this is in the notes of the last lecture. I've got a particle which is say fluctuating between two potential wells like this, and I so for example, it's let's call this well up and this one down, just for notation. Right. So the wave function might be something of the order of up times cos theta plus down times sine theta. Now, obviously, if I make a single measurement which determines whether the particle is here or here, then I'm always going to get one or the other with the appropriate probabilities, okay? A standard quantum theory measurement result. However, what happens if, for example, I were to take an ensemble of particles and repeatedly, just to select them at random, repeatedly measure this and then average the results? What would I find? Well, obviously, I'd find the probability of being up is cos squared theta. So, and that's not 1 or 0, so nothing particularly mysterious about that. Because that's one point. As long as I'm interested in some sense long-term averages, then I don't have to get values which correspond to the eigenvalues. So it's a fairly trivial point. Second point concerns the Berry phase. A general definition of the Berry phase is that I imagine that I've got a particle which is in some quantum state which depends on some external parameter. A very standard example in the textbooks would be a case in which I've got a particle of spin a half sitting in a magnetic field, say H here, what I'm going to do is to actually rotate the direction of the magnetic field around the z-axis, like so. And I would expect that when I come back to myself, I would have picked up the so-called dynamical phase, e to the minus iet over h bar, but that I can in some sense throw away. I know all about that. I may, however, have picked up an extra phase along the way. This is the interesting bit. This is the so-called Berry or Pancharatnam-Berry phase. The standard definition of the Berry phase, apart from factors of 2 pi or something which I almost certainly get wrong, is phi e to the I phi b equals integral psi star of lambda d psi of lambda by d lambda, where lambda is the external variable which I'm varying. In this case, it will be the angle of the magnetic field. And then an imaginary part of it. This does not. Something slightly wrong here. We actually want phi b itself, not e to the r phi b. Where are we? Where's my backboard dust? So the point is that in general this need not be zero if I have a, as it were, non-trivial trajectory which comes around like so. Okay, and in fact you can convince yourself that for this kind of situation, if this angle is theta here, then the Berry phase for this particular situation is going to be pi times sine squared squared theta. In particular, if my magnetic field is in the plane, so I'm just rotating my spin through 2 pi here, that's just pi, not 2 pi. Right? So it's this famous so-called 4 pi symmetry of the fermion wave function. Okay, so far? People are sort of fairly familiar with that? Okay. Now, imagine that we try to put these two considerations together. I've given you an example in the notes of the last lecture, which those of you who have it might want to refer to. Suppose I've got a situation in which I have a heavy particle which is commuting between two different potential wells, say at 0 and at r here. So these are the two possible positions of my heavy particle. And meanwhile, I've got a light particle, which doesn't necessarily have to be light, but it may as well make it so, which is constrained by energetic considerations to be in a p state relative to the heavy one. In other words, the constraint is that when I go once around here for a fixed position of the heavy particle, I've got to have a total phase change of 2 pi. I'll go around. Okay. Now the question is, suppose that over a time scale, now the heavy particle is commuting between these two points, as it were. At least that's the classical description. Right? Quantum mechanically, you'd say it's in some kind of possible superposition of eigenstates here. Imagine that over a time scale long compared to the appropriate frequency, I take a STM tip, as it were, and move the light particle around the heavy one. Question is, at the end of the day, when I've moved it right round, what Berry phase have I acquired? And the answer turns out to be, for this kind of situation, again, it's gone through in detail in your notes, that the Berry phase in this situation is 2 pi times the probability that the heavy particle be in this state here. So in other words, the the Berry phase acquired is proportional, not necessarily integral, but it's an integral multiplied by the probability that the heavy particle is, you've actually enclosed the heavy particle here. So that may not be immediately clear, so I would recommend you to go through the discussion in the notes of the last lecture on that. But anyway, let's just try to think how this applies to our question of the statistics of quasi-holes. As I say, in the many-body wave function, the amount of charge, suppose you have your one hole at the origin and you're going to move another quasar particle around it, another quasar hole, sorry, around it. The amount of charge which is confined within some region, the extra charge there, is fluctuating. If I were to take a snapshot of it and define this boundary precisely, then of course I would always get integral values of the charge. However, the average over time, if you like, or in quantum mechanics, the expectation value of the charge with respect to the ground state wave function is not necessarily integral. In fact, in this case it's a third. Right? So now if I take my second quasar particle and move it, or my second quasar hole, and move it around the first one, then according to this this result which I've got here, what I would expect is that the Berry phase I acquire is 2 pi times the average probability that there's an extra electron here. Right. And so that gives me my e to the 2 pi over 3 for encirclement, and therefore e to the I pi over 3 for interchange. Okay, I think these arguments probably take some thinking about. Any questions before I go on? Sorry?
These holes,
they have an effective mass? Good question. Let's see, how would you try to define the effective mass? To define it, I think you'd have to imagine that you can put this hole into a superposition of states weighted by e to the ik dot r. In other words, you make up a plane wave state of these holes, and then you ask what is the energy associated with that relative to the energy at rest. Remember that the hole does have a non-zero energy when it's at rest. It has, if you like, a finite rest mass. Okay, but now the question is, does it also have a dynamical effective mass in the usual sense? And I think, I'm not sure that I can do this off the top of my head, but I think the answer is not really, because it turns out that the energy spectrum is not simply proportional to k squared. If you try to make up this wave packet, it'll Okay, my suspicion is it's more complicated, but to be honest, I don't want to swear to that off the top of my head. Well, right, you don't have a... we've forgotten about the lattice here. I mean, so it's not that. The electrons, the basic electrons which go into, which is a sort of ingredients for the quantum Hall effect, of course, do have an effective mass which in general is different from the real mass. But that sort of, you know, that's a simple multiplying factor which just falls out of it, the problem mostly. If you ask about the fractional quasiparticles, then I think you have to distinguish between the what you might think of as the rest mass, that is the energy to produce one in the first place, that comes from the Coulomb interaction, and that's of the order of the characteristic. Remember, you have this characteristic Coulomb interaction EC, which is E squared over epsilon times LM, I'm being the magnetic length. But it turns out, in fact, that it's rather a small fraction of that. For quasi Hall, it's about a 1/40 of that number. And then again, as I say, if you want to ask about the dynamic effective mass, that really only makes sense if the spectrum is quadratic. And I'm fairly sure that in this case it would not be, but I don't have that in my head. Okay. Any other questions sort of left over from last time or connected with? Okay, then let's go on to the first topic that I was planning to talk about in this lecture, which is the question composite. Oh, sorry, composite fermions. Yep. Let's see, what do I have here? Sorry, did I? Marianne, did I get one of your the copies? Because it's a slightly different script. Okay, thank you.
The first part was
from yes.
And the second last 4 pages about the
composite. It's the wrong way around. I meant to do it the other way around. Never mind. Okay. Okay. Sorry. The order is a bit different from what I had intended here. The stuff I'm now going to be talking about is towards the end of the notes you just distributed. The simplest, the argument we've given so far for the fractional quantum Hall effect really only works for special values of the filling factor, namely nu equals 1 over 2n plus 1. These are the so-called Lofton states, the very simplest fractional Hall states. Now, it turns out, in fact, that although we certainly do get strong fractional quantum Hall effect plateaus at these Lofton numbers here, they're not the only ones. There are, for example, I mean, we do get 1/3, 1/5, 1/7, etc. They're always strong, fairly strong plateaus in the quantum Hall effect. However, you also get, for example, 2/3. How do we think about that? Well, that's not so mysterious, because at least as long as I assume that all the action is confined to the lowest Landau level, then I think it's fairly obvious there has to be a sort of symmetry between particles and holes. So basically the 2/3 quantum Hall effect is just the 1/3 effect for holes, as it were. Yeah. Okay. Similarly, if we've got to have something like a fraction like, say, 7/3, again, no great mystery. All that means is that the two lowest Landau levels are filled, and the ones in the third Landau level essentially undergo the 1/3 quantum Hall effect. So far, no particular mystery. But there are actually quite a lot of experimentally observed plateaus which don't correspond to these simple numbers. Like, for example, 2/5 and 4/11. Still odd denominator, but don't correspond to this simple, any of these simple pictures. So how do you deal with those? Well, there are a number of schemes in the literature, which I think the simplest conceptually certainly is the so-called composite fermion scheme, which was devised by Jane in the 80s. And it goes, I think this is worth trying to understand at least in its main aspects, because it will be important for understanding the five halves effect. So Jane's argument goes the following way. Suppose that we imagine that we have a given value of nu, which is not the one we're going to be eventually interested in, so let's call it nu star. And we have some Laughlin wave function corresponding to that. So nu star, for the moment, we can take it to be integral, although it in fact need not be. But let's assume for the moment it's integral. Psi L for well, even the ordinary integral quantum Hall effect value for nu star of z1, z2, zn. Now, let's keep let's assume n is going to be constant throughout this operation. So given that n is constant, there will be a given value of b, namely b star, which corresponds to this new star here. So it's the magnetic field we need to get that value of the filling fraction. Okay, so let's keep it n, the total number of particles, constant, but let's change the field so as to change to a new, no pun intended, a new filling factor, nu. And consider as a possible ansatz for the new wave function under this quantity here multiplied by pi j less than k up to n zi minus z or zj minus zk to the 2p. But p now is a positive integer. Now this is certainly an allowed wave function. It's non-singular, it's analytic, it's anti-symmetric. It's an anti-symmetric function of the z's because this is already anti-symmetric and this function is symmetric if p is integral. Now consider a large orbit of some particle j in the states, first of all in the original state, psi nu star, and now in the original state, which is an ansatz for psi nu. Let's compare the extra, suppose it's going around a circle, returning to itself. Compare the extra phase which you acquire in the second case relative to the first. Well, if the orbit were to encircle just one extra particle, k, the phase in question would be from this, so imagine that we hold, say, particle K fixed, we're encircling it with particle J here. You see that in that case, the phase acquired would be 2 pi times 2p. Right? And therefore, if it includes exactly n extra particles, then you just put an extra n in here, 2 pi n. 2p n. Now, here comes the delicate step, which is not at all obvious. It was, I think, a rather nice leap of intuition by Jane. Suppose that the orbit area is A, then on average, the number of particles encircled will be NA, and therefore the phase picked up will be 2 pi, 2 pi N, that's 2 pi times 2p times NS times A. area of the orbit. Now, for general values of A, of course, that's not going to be integral. However, that's just the phase which would have been picked up by an extra magnetic field, B prime, in an extra magnetic field, B prime, which is given by 2PNS times phi zero. And so we can argue, this is the, I think, the bit which is not at all obvious and was a leap of imagination. At least at the mean field level, the new problem with our filling factor nu, is equivalent to the old one with an extra field B prime. So if that's going to work, the new field B must be related to the old one B prime by this equation here, equation 2 in your notes, B minus 2P NS phi 0 is equal to B star. However, by definition, the old filling factor was NS phi 0 over B star. You're on page 2. No, sorry, but at the end of your, look, these are extra pages added at the end of your notes. So the numbering starts again. Okay. Okay. Yeah, so if you could all make sure that you're on the right, literally on the right page at this point. Okay. So the so as a result of this consideration, you find that the new filling factor is given in terms of the old one by equation 3, your notes. And, really that's quite interesting. But there's one slightly tricky point here. There's actually nothing which stops you replacing the factor zj minus zk to the 2p by its complex conjugate. In other words, taking z star j minus z star k. Strictly speaking, that means you now have an expression which is not analytic in the z's, but you're going to take the square of that, and what is squared, so that doesn't hurt you. And so now the only difference in the argument is that the fictitious magnetic field has its sign reversed. It's now minus 2 PNS phi 0 here. And the difference that makes is that it introduces also the possibility of a minus sign in equation 3. So at the end of the day, what you predict, you find, is that nu is equal to nu star over 2p nu star plus or minus 1. In other words, if you get if you have a solution for nu star, then you can construct one for any nu which is related to nu star with any positive integer value of p and either the plus or minus sign here. One thing you do have to just worry about a little, which the review articles and so forth tend to screw up, I'm afraid, is that you do have to renormalize your length scale when you've gone from B to B star. So the exponential factor in the Laughlin expression now has to be rescaled to be the actual magnetic length and not the original one. Now, okay, one obvious choice of nu star here is simply 1, the original integral quantum Hall effect for n equals 1. And then the new values which we derive from that are just, 2p plus or minus 1, they basically give you the same series, 1/3, 1/5, 1/7, etc., the original Laughlin states. So that of course doesn't give you anything new. Moreover, if you choose nu star to itself be a Laughlin value, 1 over 2n plus 1, that just reproduces the another Laughlin state series. So far, nothing new. But the amusing point is that no one tells you that the original filling factor, nu star, has to be less than or equal to 1. The next most obvious choice is some integer greater than 1. So, for example, let's choose n equals 2, and so nu star equals 2 here, and put p equal to 1, then you get 2/3 and 2/5. Again, these are experimentally observed values of the quantum Hall plateaus, but they are not the original Lofton values. Okay. Now, there's one very obvious objection to all of this, which is if you start with a value of nu star which is greater than 1, then you would expect your wave function to contain single particle components which correspond to higher lambda levels. On the other hand, to get to where we've got to so far, we assume that in the limit where the Coulomb interaction is small compared to the Zeeman term, then the many-body wave function should be made up entirely out of the lowest lambda level states. So that looks as if we have a contradiction. Turns out, very remarkably, I think this is not something one can easily understand intuitively, but it does actually turn out that once you take your original Laughlin state wave functions, or your original, let's say integral for the moment, your original integral quantum Hall effect wave functions for the second Landau level. Now remember, those correspond to, for example, in the radial gauge, those correspond to the first excited state of the harmonic oscillator, not the ground state. You take those wave functions, you multiply it by this factor Zij minus Zk to the 2p. Lo and behold, what you get is basically just the first set of first Landau level wave functions. And in fact, it numerical simulations do appear to support this. So everything does appear to be self-consistent. Let me just stop for a moment and ask if there are any questions there. I think this Jane argument is at first sight a little puzzling. It's surprising that it works, but it does seem to, as far as we can tell. Okay, well, one rather remarkable prediction follows immediately from the Jane approach. That concerns the case where nu equals half. The actual value of the filling factor is a half. So exactly one electron per two flux quanta. Where does that come? If you look at this in the Jane picture, what value of nu star do you have to have here? Well, I think it's fairly obvious. What you actually need, nu equals a half, corresponds to nu star equals infinity. But remember that one possible definition of nu, which is equivalent to our original one, is that apart from a factor, a numerical factor, nu is of the order of EF divided by H bar omega C. So the limit that nu star goes to infinity means nu star is the order epsilon over omega C goes to infinity, corresponds to, if we keep epsilon F fixed, corresponds to H omega C goes to zero. So in other words, nu equals a half in your original problem corresponds to no magnetic field at all. And obviously values of nu close to a half correspond to very large values of nu star, and therefore small values of omega C. So this then this suggests then that at nu equals a half, the resulting problem should behave in some sense very much like the behavior of free fermions in very low or zero magnetic field. In particular, you should be able to see quasi-classical orbits which correspond to this very low field. Remember that the lower the magnetic field, the larger the orbits, and therefore you, if this idea is right, then you should be able to see effects on a scale which is very long compared to the magnetic length. And indeed, there have been some beautiful experiments along these lines, and people have observed periodicities which appear to correspond to an effective magnetic field which is extremely small. So Now, how you actually visualize this, I think, is a slightly messy and delicate matter. People usually talk in terms of thinking of so-called composite fermions as being the original fermions plus two quanta of flux attached to them. I'm not, well, okay, you may like that picture, you may not. I don't find it myself particularly helpful, but some people do. But anyway, the formal results do seem to work out rather well. As far as we can tell, almost all the experimental evidence on the new equals a half state does say that it can be regarded as a system which is a set of non-interacting so-called composite fermions in this way. Okay, very briefly, what is the what's the effective charge associated with these non-Laughlin states? Well, at first sight, you might think it would, for example, for the two-fifth state, you might think the effective charge should be two-fifths of the electron charge. Turns out that's probably not right. The answer is it's just basically the denominator which counts. In other words, the effective charge should be, in the case for nu equals two-fifths, the E star is actually not two-fifths of E, but rather one-fifth of E. That's a slightly delicate matter. I won't go into it unless anyone's particularly interested. I think the arguments for in the literature for that are somewhat hand-waving, frankly. But and there's no, as far as I know at least, there's no direct experimental evidence on that point right now, one way or the other. Okay, that's what I intended to say about non-Laughlin states and the composite fermion idea, rather generally. Before I go on to the specific case of nu equals five halves, let me just stop and ask if there are any questions or comments. Okay, so let's go on then to the to nu equals five halves. I'm not sure I have the right copy here. Quite early on in the game, I think around 1987, only a few years into the quantum Hall effect business, it was discovered that there was at least one value of the filling factor at which you got a substantial plateau, which did not appear to correspond to an odd denominator. And this is precisely at nu equals five halves. Now, at first sight, this might seem rather strange, because we've just seen that at nu equals one half, you get this effective Fermi liquid of composite fermions, and you get this very characteristic behavior, which is not, let me just emphasize, nu equals one half experimentally does not correspond to a fractional Hall state, quantum Hall state. It corresponds rather to this, what looks like a Fermi liquid state of composite fermions. But at five halves, we really do get a decent plateau with all the usual properties. Rxy is five halves, E squared over, sigma xy, the conductance, five halves, E squared over h. The longitudinal conductivity is rigorously zero, etc., etc. Why do you get this qualitative difference between the behavior at nu equals one half and at five halves? At first sight, you'd say to yourself, look, these have to be essentially the same, because all that's happened is that at nu equals five halves, we've completely occupied the lowest Landau level. Remember, you've got to take two spin populations into account. So you've filled up the lowest Landau level for both spin up and spin down, and you're just left with the states in the second Landau level, which then effectively have a nu equals a half. Well, probably that's not, that argument is not really right, and the reason is that in some sense the filling fractor looks the same, But the actual microscopic eigenstates that you're talking about really are rather different. Remember, in the lowest Landau level, they're the lowest harmonic oscillator states. In the second Landau level, they're going to be the first excited state of the harmonic oscillator, which has nodes and so forth. So the effect of interactions does not necessarily have to be the same, or even qualitatively the same in the two cases. And it looks like experimentally as if that's what happens. Well, yeah, actually, just as a sort of aside, the second Landau level, or the states which occur in the second Landau level, that is, for filling factors between 2 and 4, is actually rather a peculiar beast. When you have nu less than 2, in other words, when you're only dealing with the lowest Landau level, then, at first sight at least, it looks like everything is pretty straightforward. The composite fermion picture does appear to work. You get the Laughlin states, you get the Fermi liquid state at nu equals a half, etc., etc. Everything looks rather straightforward and simple. If you go up to nu greater than 4, then basically most of the quantum Hall stuff goes away. It turns out that you still get integral quantum Hall states up to about nu equals 7 or so, maybe higher. Nu equals 7 is as far as anyone's seen them. No one, as far as I know, has yet seen a fractional quantum Hall effect with nu greater than 4. So the third Landau level, in some sense, well, it appears to, it's normal, in the sense it does show an integral quantum Hall effect. It does not appear to show anything complicated, more complicated than that. So nu equals, so the second Landau level, that's nu between 2 and 4, that appears to, in some sense, be in competition between these two types of behavior. So sometimes you seem to get standard fractional quantum Hall behavior, sometimes you don't, and particularly for the case nu equals 5 halves, so you get something new. Well, how are we going to... Let me say a word about one or two other characteristics of the experimental properties of the 5 half state. It does appear to be fairly robust. Both the plateau in the Hall resistance and the zero of the longitudinal resistance do extend over a considerable range of the order of 0.1 in nu. The excitation gap, again, is reasonably large. It appears to be, at least at first sight, now this is a complicated matter, first sight the excitation gap appears to be an exponential function of disorder. It appears to be quite a sharp function of disorder. To date, the highest measured values are somewhere around half a degree. If we extrapolate the curves to zero disorder, we would get a value of about 0.6 k. That incidentally corresponds to about 0.6% of the Coulomb, the standard Coulomb gap. That's in the ballpark which we predicted for the fractional quantum Hall effect. Magnetic field dependence, if B, the perpendicular component of B and hence the filling factor, is held constant and the parallel component is varied, then apparently delta decreases linearly with B parallel. Now remember that B parallel, according to all the usual conceptions, well, most of the usual conceptions, the parallel component of B cannot affect the orbital motion, at first sight at least. However, it can affect the spin. So it looks as if this perpendicular component of magnetic field is affecting the spins rather substantially, and that, of course, would tend to indicate that you're starting off with a spin singlet state, in other words, an unpolarized system, and you're creating polarization. But as we'll see, that argument may be too naive, and we'll come back to it. We are now on page 2 and 3 of the first part of the notes. Finally, I should just mention that they're the only system in which the 5/2 fractional quantum effect has been reliably seen appears to be gallium arsenide heterostructures. It's not been seen, as far as I know, at least in silicon MOSFETs, for example. And secondly, nu equals 5/2 is almost unique. There are two other possible values, nu equals 7/2, which would be the particle hole symmetric version of nu equals 5/2, and also nu equals 19/8, but the evidence for that is very, very, very weak. So, but basically 5/2 appears to be a real, honest-to-goodness, fractional quantum Hall effect. Oh, okay, good. Yeah, absolutely. Graphene, yes. In graphene, you do see see half integral values. That's as far as we understand it, at least. I haven't talked about this in detail, but we understand that as a consequence of the very peculiar energy spectrum of graphene. Remember that all our discussion has been based on the assumption that in free space, the electrons in question would just propagate with an ordinary effective mass. In other words, the energy would be squared over 2m or m star, right? In graphene, that's not the case. The energy is linear in momentum. That gives you a different state of affairs. So yeah, thank you. And we could perhaps, if necessary, say something in a later lecture about that if you're particularly interested. How do we think about this, about what's going on here? Well, let's go back for a moment to the nu equals 1/2 state. We saw that all the evidence is that just behaves as an ordinary Fermi liquid of composite fermion particles. And that the wave function in that case, so in that case, the actual wave function corresponding to that, we psi 1/2 of z1 to zn, would be just pi over j less than k up to n of zj minus zk squared times Fermi C. times the ordinary Fermi C. However, we know that's not apparently what's going on at nu equals 5/2. But let's use that as a starting point and ask what kinds of instability could a Fermi C undergo? Well, lots and lots, actually, but most of them turn out not to be particularly relevant. Either they don't occur at all, or they occur at temperatures of the order of EF. For example, crystallization is a case. So that doesn't seem to be relevant here. But there is one kind of instability which we know is very ubiquitous in real life Fermi gases, like the electrons in ordinary three-dimensional metals and so forth, and that is Cooper pairing, which leads to a superconducting state. Now, in this case, the Cooper pairs are before we start thinking about this further, we do have to decide whether we think that in the at nu equals 5/2 we have any spin polarization or not. Now that's actually complicated question from an experimental point of view. You might think at first sight it was rather straightforward to determine whether you have a spin polarized or spin unpolarized system. But just think about it. What are you actually going to measure? Most obvious proposal is to measure the total magnetization. But you're only dealing, remember, with a two-dimensional system, and moreover, a very low-density two-dimensional system. So the magnetization is really extremely small, and as far as I know, it's not been possible to detect that directly with for example, squid magnetometry. There are various other proposals, and there have been a lot of ingenious experiments over the last few years to try to measure this. One nice idea is that you try to measure the hyperfine energy, but you're now doing it uniformly for the sample, not for a particular nucleus. So So you know what the you have a particular nucleus, in this case, say one of the arsenic nuclei. You know what the resonance frequency in free space is. The so-called night shift is the difference between the resonance frequency in free space and in a metal. So you try to measure the night shift for your quantum Hall system. How do you do this? Well, crudely, it's quite an ingenious technique. It's been used in a couple of papers in the literature. You start off with the system in equilibrium. You then try to perturb it with a standard transverse RF magnetic field. Now, how do you? Next question: how do you tell what you've done with that magnetic field? You think you've created a nuclear, in this case a nuclear polarization, but how do you tell whether you've created it or not? Answer: well, you can measure that by its effect on the resistivity, because the nuclei will scatter electrons differently via the hyperfine interaction, depending on whether they're polarized or not. And this is something you can measure independently. So people have tried to do these experiments, but the trouble is you really have to compare. What you have to try to do is to compare the hyperfine field acting on the nuclei in the nu equals 5/2 state to one in other neighbouring states, which are, okay, because that's the only way in some sense you're going to be able to calibrate that that effect. And there have been a couple of experiments in the literature which have done this, but whether you regard these as reliable or not, I think is to some extent a matter of taste. If you read, there's a rather comprehensive review article, which is by now a couple of years old, by Willett, which is referenced on page one of your lecture notes. Willett does discuss these experiments and concludes really that they're not conclusive. This is, I think, to me, this is somewhat impressive, because I think Willett himself has a really, in some sense, a rather strong reasons for wanting the state to be spin polarized, and the fact that he concludes that the evidence for this is not definitive is therefore, I think, somewhat impressive. But you'll see why later, why he might want them to be spin polarized. Okay, so let's put that question aside for a minute, and just assume that indeed we are talking about a totally spin polarized system, which after all is what we've been talking about so far mostly. What then? Well, as I say, you might assume that what's happening is that you in some sense start with a Fermi liquid, and that the system then would like to form Cooper pairs. But if it forms Cooper pairs, it's going to actually, they can't be in a standard S state. For spin parallel electrons, that's going to violate the Pauli exclusion principle.
So what's the reason that it wants to form Cooper pair again now?
It might or might not. we don't know a priori that it does, but very crudely speaking, if there is some kind of effective attraction between the particles of the system, in this case, remember, we're actually not talking about the real electrons, we're talking about these composite fermions. Okay, if there is some kind of effective attraction between them, then according to the usual considerations of BCS and so forth, we would expect them to want to try to form some kind of bound state. I mean, I will talk, obviously the last few of the lectures of this series are going to be about superconductivity, so I'll talk about this in much more detail, but crudely speaking, whenever you have some kind of effective attraction, then you're liable to get a bound state, that is, Cooper-paired state formed.
Okay, since you're going to talk about, in any case, I thought, of course, that is kind of like, then there are many systems in which there are attraction between pairs that don't form. I thought, you need to have some kind of phase change,
Let me try to refine the statement somewhat. I mean, it's a good point. There are Obviously, there are many, many situations known where you have some kind of basic objects, let's say, not necessarily electrons, but say atoms. You have atoms with some kind of attraction between them, and the odds are they're not going to do anything like this. They're going to form a solid, crystalline solid, or something similar. But I think one can make the following statement with a certain amount of confidence. If I have a system of fermions, if I start off with a system of fermions which are non-interacting and therefore and are moving in some kind of free space volume, so that they're forming a Fermi C, okay, and I then switch on some kind of weak effective attraction between them. For example, I can think about let's just think for the moment. Let's go back to the standard unpolarized situation. So I've got both spin up and spin down electrons around. I switch on a short-range attractive interaction, say. Then there are rather general arguments that these will form Cooper pairs, and therefore to display the main phenomena of superconductivity. So you have to, as it were, be sure that you're starting from something which looks roughly like a non-interacting gas. So in this case, this is not trivial because the so-called non-interacting gas from which you're starting is not the gas of free electrons, it's the gas of these composite fermions. And as I say, I find it difficult to, in some sense, get some kind of visualization of those, but this is what's been done in the literature.
So if you are able to get visualizations, then the composite fermions, like in the Cooper pair, got this, not both condensate, but some
kind
of condensate
now. That's right.
And again, the local variance, which you said the local gauging variance, which you said you're going to cover later on, and the global gauging variance will also apply in this particular situation.
That is the how to put it, at least if you go back and try to write it in terms of the composite fermions, then the topological features of the many body wave functions should look similar to what they are for real superconductor. That's only true. So let's just assume for the moment that this idea is roughly right. Then what would you assume is going to be the rough form of the many body wave function? Okay, well, if this is right for the Fermi C the free Fermi C of composite fermions, then a natural ansatz for the BCS state is going to be psi 5, let's write this psi 5 half, C1, Cn, is equal to pi j less than k, Ci minus, Zj minus Zk squared, times a BCS wave function. Now, remember that the BCS wave function you're now talking about is corresponds to parallel spin particles. What kind of BCS state do you get for that? Well, the simplest kind of state is a P state. But the P state can be various kinds. For example, you can have an order parameter. Again, this is something we'll talk about in much more detail in the last few lectures of the course. But you can have an order parameter which is simply proportional to kx or ky. But it turns out that, at least in two dimensions, that's almost certainly not energetically advantageous. The most most obvious form of the order parameter is delta of k is proportional to kx plus iky. Now, delta here is, we have to say what we mean by delta k of here. It's often defined as the so-called energy gap, but I think a more useful definition is proportional, at least, to the actual amplitude of the pair wave function as a function of the relative coordinate. Again, talk about this more later. But important point to note here is that this amplitude squared, which gives you the probability, is now proportional to this squared, so it's isotropic. So even though the order parameter itself has this angular dependence, which is not trivial, its square, which is, crudely speaking, the probability of finding particles in these states k and minus k relative to one another, that is actually isotropic, independent of angle. So this is the original conjecture of Moore and Reed. However, there's one thing that we probably shouldn't take too seriously here. We have, okay, I'll go about this, yes. The final state for the Moore-Reed wave function is actually not quite this. And we'll see in a moment why it's not quite that. Let me just forget about cube of pairs. Let me come back and go in from another angle. The angle is that we want to write down some kind of many-body wave function for the new equals 5/2 state, which will give us all the usual fractional quantum four-hall effect behavior. So as I say, we're not now assuming a priori is going to form cubic pairs. We'll do something a bit different. Okay. So now, if we were just dealing with the standard Laughlin state, of course, what we would write is that psi Laughlin, corresponding to a value nu, would be pi j less than k up to n, just get j minus zk to the qth exponential minus the usual magnetic squared 4 lm squared. Okay, where Q here is simply 1 over nu. That was the Laughlin wave function that we wrote down for example, nu equals a third. Right. Now, what happens if we try to do this for nu equals a half? Well, then we'd just get a squared in here. But that would be a disaster if we leave it at that point. Why? Well, because the wave function would then be symmetric rather than antisymmetric under interchange of zj and zk. Right? So we have to try to modify that somehow. Now, the various ways of trying to modify it, but the one which Moore and Reed hit on, and they had all sorts of, as a matter of fact, they actually came to this conclusion via considerations of so-called conformal field theory and so forth, which I won't attempt to go into here. But it's a rather roundabout way. But what they eventually decided was that the way that this has to be modified, the simplest way to modify this wave function so as to make it properly antisymmetric, is to multiply this by a so-called Pfaffian. ZJ, well, it's a specific form of Pfaffian, Pfaffian of 1 over ZJ minus ZK. Okay, so what do we mean by a Pfaffian here? It's basically, if I have some function, if ZI, ZJ, then basically the Pfaffian of this simply consists of taking this function, What I do is to first of all write down f of z1, z2, f of z3, z4, f of zn minus 1, zn. I assume for the moment I've got an even number of particles. So I'm going to be interested in the specific case where this is actually antisymmetric. Minus f of zj zi. So it's already, so this expression is already antisymmetric when I interchange 1 and 2, or 3 and 4, etc. However, I want to do better than that. I want to make sure it's antisymmetric with respect to interchange of any two particles. So what I now do is to subtract from that, for example, f of z1, z3, f of, let's for a moment make it z1, z4, yes, that'll do, f z3, z2, dot. So you see I've interchanged two of the indices and put in a minus sign. And so I do that for all possible interchanges. So in this case, I'm going to take my function f to be 1 over zj minus zk here. And that then is the, that's the Moore-Reed ansatz for the many-body wave function. That is, we just take the what would have been the Laughlin wave function but didn't have the right symmetry and multiply it by this factor here. Now this looks at first sight a very awkward operation, and one might well ask, well, you know, what's special about that particular choice here? Well, okay, here's something, here's one way of beginning to justify it. Let's go back now to our alternative argument via the idea of Cooper pairing. So what is the BCS wave function for my original electrons? Well, we can actually write it in coordinate space. Now, this was not actually, there's an interesting bit of history here. From the time when BCS first did their work, which is 1957, up to around 1990, it was very unfashionable to write one's BCS wave function in coordinate space. And part of the reason for that, and this is something I'll come back to in the lectures on superconductivity, part of the reason for that is that if you write things in coordinate space, then obviously you have to talk about specific particles. In other words, you have to label your particles 1, 2, 3, etc. And in particular, you must automatically consider states where the total number of particles is fixed. But BCS had actually got a lot of mileage out of the idea that it was convenient to relax this constraint on the total number of particles, and for reasons which I think were very bad ones, this idea became enshrined in the literature. The notion that somehow this so-called breaking, the technical name is spontaneous breaking of U1 symmetry, it became a sort of dogma in the literature on superconductivity that this was really a fundamental feature of the theory, which I think is totally wrong. But people didn't much like to write down real space wave functions because it obviously violated that principle. But around 1990, when Moore and Reed did their first work on this, it became realised that actually, at least in the quantum Hall context, it might be rather useful to do this. So what does this look like? Well, it's a rather nasty mess, to be honest. The reason it was so convenient for BCS to relax particle number conservation is it gives you a very concise and compact form of the many-body wave function, as we'll see. However, if you then try to transcribe that into coordinate space, as we're going back to conserving your number of particles, it really looks quite messy. Again, we'll see that in more detail. Luckily, however, it turns out that if you go, as it were, to sufficiently long distances, that is, you consider as the limit of this wave function when all your particles are fairly far apart, then it turns out you get a much simpler structure, and lo and behold, the structure is precisely this. This Pfaffian here. Now, as a matter of fact, again, I'm going to come back to this point later in the context of superconductivity. That is actually based on a particular ansatz for the p-wave pairing function, which I personally believe is not unique, but it's the one which has been used in the literature consistently. So if we believe that, then, as I say, this is the right form of the long wavelength form of the BCS wave function for k, so-called kx plus i ky pairing. And that's what Moore and Reed wrote down. And they actually realized this this connection there. Okay. Will, I'm not quite sure what to do at this point. I have to stop now because it's we're up to time. I didn't get to the most interesting part and the most sort of quantum information relevant part of the discussion of the five-half state, which is this question of the quasi-particle statistics. They're supposed to be non-abelian anyons and so forth. And so I think that might be nice to try to discuss that, but that means I have slightly less time on superconductivity. So what do people feel? Should we just stop on the quantum Hall effect here and go on to superconductivity, or should we have another one more lecture or so on the quantum Hall effect? Any? Sorry? You want to go on to superconductivity? No? Okay, fine. But unfortunately let's hope we have time at the end of the course to come back to the five halves, because you had a suggestion?
Oh yeah, I have a question. Physically, the origin of superconductivity is believed to be the two fermions because pair, and it is some boson-like pseudo condensation. Mm-hmm. There is
that's one way. Yeah, that's good.
But in this case, the two anions paired, so it does not need to be a boson-like.
Well, no, hang on. We haven't yet got to anions. In the five halves context, okay? We talked about anions in the nu equals a third case, sorry. But so far we haven't got, because the reason we haven't got to them is that we haven't yet talked about, we're still talking about the ground state. We haven't got to the question of excitations yet. It's only when we get to the question of excitations that the anionic nature will come up. Okay, so, is the consensus then that I should go on to superconductivity in the next one? Okay, hopefully we might get time to come back to this, because I think it is a shame not to say a little about these anionic statistics. Although I think it's a very confusing and messy subject. Okay, fine. So see you on Tuesday.